Okay, well, first, Joyce, thanks for giving me a chance to speak today. This is really exciting. My name is Kent Stack. I'm a diabetes dad. I think as Joyce had mentioned before. I spent most of my life in technology. Okay, I started my career as an engineer, but over the years, you know, moved on to management and started some companies and things like that. So I hadn't written a line of code since 1993, which was in Fortran. Okay, until about a year and a half ago, my son Ryan, he was diagnosed when he was 4 here at the U of M. We live here in Ann Arbor, and he was always in pretty good control. You know, we're kind of type A parents, so we were kind of all over the numbers and constantly faxing people like Joyce and anyone else we could to try to help us with his numbers. And we were kind of on, I'll call it, diabetes autopilot, okay? And then he hit about 12 or 13. His numbers were always really good, and then he became a teenager, and hormones kicked in, and keeping control over a teenager with diabetes is, needless to say, a bit of a struggle. And so, you know, yeah, that's what's nice. So, you know, things are okay, though. I think for most people, they'd say he was doing great. And Joyce, knowing I was a tech guy, sends me an email about a year and a half ago. Say, hey, there's this guy named Constant coming to speak about this makehealth thing, and he's hacked at Dexcom. I said, Constant? Well, John Constant? She said, yeah, John Constant. So the funny part about all this is John Constant worked for me 25 years ago, okay, as an 18 or 19-year-old lab technician, right, back when we were both at Kodak, believe it or not. And I remember when his son Evan got diagnosed, he'd sent me an email and said, oh, you know, Ryan, and I sent Gary Shiner's book, and we chatted, and then we lost touch again. And so I show up at this Maker Health thing, and there's John Costing, you know, saying he can put CGM data in the cloud. And I was absolutely shocked. And literally a week later, I switched from Medtronic to Dexcom, and about 4 hours later, I had a Pebble watch, and there was his blood sugar, okay? And it was the most transformational experience we'd had in 10 plus years of diabetes, okay? Not even close. There's nothing else. My son plays lots of sports. He's an avid athlete. He's a drummer. He does all sorts of stuff, and it has made all the difference, okay? But the thing that, to me, about Nightscout that's so powerful is that not just the software. The software is amazing, okay? You guys have nailed remote monitoring. But what Nightscout did for me, and I think for a lot of others, and that's sort of my job here to talk about, is it inspired us that we can actually do something. I spent 10 years of Ryan, my son's life, really not doing anything but managing his diabetes, okay? I didn't write any code, I didn't build anything, okay? I didn't use my skills to try to better his life and other people's lives. So what Nightscout inspired me to do, and I think hundreds of others to do, is to go way beyond just remote monitoring. So I'm gonna spend about 10 or 15 minutes or so talking about hacking diabetes, and as people have called us, citizen hackers, okay? And sorry, my logo's up there for my sort of day job. But Perceptus.org is another not-for-profit done for exactly the same reasons James said. I started this with another type 1 hacker named Gustavo Munoz down in Mexico, and we write a number of open source software tools for type 1 diabetes. I'll talk about a couple of them along with a lot of the other efforts that are going on. And so I'm going to break it down quickly into, so as when Joyce talked about the stuff, I said, well, how would I kind of break it down? I'm going to break it down really into four areas. The first one is mobile display, and I think Joyce and James talked a bit about that already. I'll talk about some of the resources that are out there now for dashboarding, for analysis, for exploration, for decision. I'll then talk about community hardware. This is hardware that we're all building, okay, to again try to better the diabetes tech. And finally, I'll finish with some discussion about remote control and the infamous closed loop, which does exist. Okay, in fact, it's existed for actually quite a long time. And I'll leave you with some thoughts at the end about sort of where I think that goes next. But hopefully this will be interesting. And again, my goal here is not to get into the gory details of the tech, but really to give you kind of a flavor for what's going on there. So mobile display is huge. And mobile display is huge for people like my son. My son does not want to feel like a diabetic every 5 minutes. He honestly doesn't want to pull out his CGM receiver, okay, and has his CGM on his stomach, and he's got his pump. He feels like the Borg, right? He's got all this tech, right? Okay, and he's a 15-year-old going on 16, he's talking to some girl, right? Does he really want to have to pull his receiver out and start blaring at him? He looks kind of weird, right? He doesn't want that. So one of the things that I think mobile display did was give us glanceability. I thought that clip art I found up there was just perfect, because now he doesn't have to pull out, as he calls it, his nerd receiver, okay? Right? He doesn't, he just kind of looks at his Apple Watch. Hey, that's cool. Right, I'm going up and going down. He now gets silent alerts. okay? The worst thing for him, right, the Dexcom and the Medtronic CGM before it changed our lives, right? His control is really good. He's much safer. He plays lots and lots of sports. Your blood sugar can drop just shockingly fast when you're playing sports, right? And now he just gets a buzz on his wrist versus everybody in the room knowing that he's going high or low. For him, that is huge. Not only is he safer, but he's, quote unquote, to him, more normal. And that's what I want for my son. Okay, so mobile display was everything. And the amazing thing about Nightscout is all these different solutions are out there, all of which are free, right? The one that the folks at Nightscout started was on the Pebble, which is probably by far the most prolific because of its cost. Scott Hanselman wrote one for the Microsoft Band. I think James mentioned, somebody mentioned the simple computer with John Kostick. There's a couple different solutions for the Apple Watch. The one down here is from MyBG, the one that we wrote up there for NS Apple up there with the graph. There's tons of solutions for Android, but the point here is this. The point here is discretion, right? I don't want everybody in the world to know I'm a diabetic all the time, right? I want to keep my stuff to me, okay? And for those kids that have this, and for adults as well, this was gigantic. And I think this was really the next evolutionary step for Nightscout. So dashboards and analysis, there's tons of tools out there from the pump companies, the CGM companies. And if anybody wants copies of this, I'll just send you the overview. You know, the first one, at least I was aware of, and I remember downloading this like 2 days after I got on Nightscout, something called Chromadex, which a guy wrote. For Macs and desktops to allow them to go interact with the Dexcom CGM sensor and just get more accessibility to data and create reports. Because here's the thing, someone showed a big picture, I think Joyce, of a draw full of cords and stuff, and I used to live that, and I'm a tech guy, and I hated it, okay? It was a freaking nightmare. My wife, very smart PhD psychologist, cannot do it, okay? It is not easy to deal with, okay? It is a mess, okay? But now here's the thing, all that data is in the cloud. Right? Once you have Nightscout or Share or something else, all that data, it's already there. Now we just need to mine it. And I want to mine it non-invasively. Right? I don't want people plugging in cores and to click on things, remember passwords and all that sort of stuff. So Chromadex, I think, was really the first step towards that. That was really cool. You can get reports and how your averages were by day, and you didn't have to do anything. Okay? When Gustavo and I set up Perceptus.org, we want to do something similar. But we actually have some software now that will email it to you when you're having a problem. So maybe I don't want to report every day, right? I want to know, though, that, hey, at noon on Thursdays, I'm going high, right? Or at midnight on Wednesdays, I'm going low, right? Show me the trend, but don't show it to me every 5 seconds. I get, how many emails do you guys get a day, right? I don't want that. Show me when I'm having a problem. So this is a live dashboard. This is actually some Ryan stuff that sits there, and you can use it as a dashboard. Okay, it shows you where you've been. It also shows you where you're going. Right. So the graph on the upper right is where you're going to be, we think, in the next 3 hours. So that's the average of the last 4 weeks for the next 3 hours at that time of day, right, for the next year. It's pretty cool. Right. Starts to give you a little bit of prediction. This is a heat map for the last 4 weeks. This is your averages, etc. So all these things, though, what's really cool is they're all free, right? And the data's already, all you do is type in your password, right, from your MongoLab stuff, and you just get it. I think that's really the cool thing about this stuff, less invasive. The other area of work that's out there, I think that's been absolutely amazing and transformative for people that follow it, and we need to figure out how to make it more accessible to people, is there's a lot of parents out there that are doing analysis on diabetes based on their data. There's a guy in Belgium, a good friend of mine, Pierre Van de Veen. He's an ex-medical professional and started a software security company, semi-retired, and he's done phenomenal work on the Dexcom, understanding when and where, for example, to calibrate, how accurate it is. That's his kid up there wearing two different CGMs, okay? He's a great lab patient like my son, you know, and he's doing studies comparing Dexcom CGM to the Libre, what happens when you take a shower, what happens in this condition, that condition. It's really pretty incredible stuff. If you read his blog, I've learned a ton of stuff. And again, all free, okay? On the right, there's something called the Human Heat Blogspot in the UK. This guy actually reverse engineered the new Dexcom semi-closed loop control system for the 640G, right? Compared it to Nightscout, compared it to some predictors in Nightscout, and we're using it for OpenAPS, okay? The amount of information that's out there today by parents that are doing quote-unquote open source research, I think is pretty incredible. Some of the stuff that Pierre's done is far better than any published paper I've seen. Far better. So decisions. So there's a couple, actually. I say couple, like a married couple out in Seattle named Dana Lewis and Scott Liebrand. And years ago, they started writing a software to help Dana, who's a diabetic, make decisions. Okay? So they had the Dexcom CGM, they upload the data to the cloud, and then they start to write some sort of said, hey, you know, it's Thursday, you have whatever going on today, lower your insulin rate. Maybe you're going to work out on Thursdays. Okay? Or hey, you're about to eat, maybe you should take more insulin right now. So really decision support, we'll call it. And this is actually some of this logic of some of the stuff that's leading to some of the opening pancreas stuff I'll talk about in a second. On the right side, this is some software again from Gustavo and I called Glucagon. We've actually had now probably well over 100 users. This is actually an educational tool that allows you to put in to the software what you're about to eat, how much insulin you're about to give yourself, and it calculates, based on a simulation, where you're going to be over the next 3 or 4 hours. But we did it with sliders. So now you can say, hey, if I'm going to eat this much and give myself this much insulin, what happens when I start to change it? For the first time, for those diabetic parents that are in the office, my son said, oh, that's why you want me to pre-bolus.
Yeah.
I get it. 15 years later, right? You know, me drawing these curves and explaining, when he could actually use a slider and see where his blood sugar is going to be in a few hours based on timing of insulin and food, he finally said, oh, I get it now. Okay? And our latest version actually will track where you are versus your simulated stuff, okay, from Nightscout. So it's kind of cool. You can actually overlay the real curve. So community hardware, this to me is really just pretty amazing. And back in 2013, there's a guy down in New Zealand, a very famous software guy named Adrian DeCroix. He owns a company called Cubic. Adrian, if you guys are old like me, okay, you remember stuff like Telnet and stuff like this. Well, that was him. Okay, so a very smart guy, diabetic child, and he said, you know, loves Dexcom, amazing product. I just don't want this receiver anymore. It's kind of big. It looks like a 1990s vintage kind of iPod. Absolutely, no offense, Nate. Please, okay. We love your stuff. We love your stuff. Okay. But so what he did is he actually spent many hours reverse engineering the RF packets coming out of the Dexcom. He then programmed a tiny little RF reader-writer called Wixel, okay, and then he can get rid of the receiver. Okay, because the CGM is kicking off RF signals every 5 minutes, telling the receiver what the last reading was. He reverse engineers the whole thing, okay, and puts his code up on the internet. And now he can stick that little Wixel in his phone, and off he goes. No more receiver, no more brick. Kind of cool, right? But honestly, super techie, there was like 4 users, right? Then there's a guy named Stephen Black, okay? He's in his early 20s, software programmer for ShopKeeper down in New York City, okay? And Stephen says, you know, I don't want to carry, he gets diagnosed at age 20-something, okay? Gets a Dexcom and meeting and says, I don't want to carry this thing around. This is pre-Bluetooth share days, okay? And he goes off and says, you know, he finds this Wixel thing on the internet from Adrian, right? He says, you know, I'm just going to build myself a little wireless version of this. I don't like wires. I want something really small. And he creates what is now known as Extra, okay, which took Adrian's Wixel, a Bluetooth transmitter, and now it transmits wirelessly to his phone. Very, very cool. And I'll explain a little more detail in a second of that. And there's even a newer project version of this called Parakeet, which now doesn't use Bluetooth anymore, just has a cell phone built right into the little box. Okay? But you can imagine the hundreds, if not thousands, of hours that goes into this stuff. What's even more amazing for Xtrip, and Wes, maybe you know the actual numbers of Xtrips out there. There's got to be hundreds and hundreds, though, of Xtrips that are out there, I think, at this point. Right?
Massive.
Hundreds. Okay?
It's exploded worldwide.
It's exploded. There are gory, detailed instructables about how to build this. There are videos teaching people how to solder your Xtrip just by the community. I mean, it is absolutely, there's build an Xtrip for dummies, okay, on the internet right now. I mean, it is absolutely incredible, right? That is absolutely incredible. That is not the simplest thing to do. You've got to, you know, you got to flash the Wixel with some C code, and you got to, you know, oh my God, you know, and hundreds of people have no business soldering anything or building these things, right? Because the need is there, right? For their kid or for themselves. It's really pretty incredible. I think the Tic Tac box is actually the most popular configuration at this point, right?
Yes, one of the interesting things is we actually have a grandmother who does this.
Yeah.
And she said, I couldn't do anything until she realized she could save $550. So she started.
Sorry. About 550.
Exactly. She started building it, but she doesn't stop at this point. She then goes and puts the craft version on it.
Nice, nice. So I think Extra, by far, at least to date, is the largest sort of community hardware project. But again, none of this happens, I think, without being inspired by Nightscout, right? By the fact that, hey, we can actually go do something. The last thing I'll talk about is hacking insulin pumps, okay? And this is kind of scary. We can talk maybe during the panel about even some experiences I've had scaring the hell out of myself that I was going to kill some user, right, with some of the stuff that I've done on this, because it's an important discussion. But back in 2011, there's a kind of crazy guy out in San Francisco, type 1 diabetic, Ben West. And Ben West, he's not only a major contributor to Nightscout, but he's sort of the father of hacking insulin pumps. Okay, he got really upset that, in fact, he couldn't get data off his insulin pump easily. So back in 2011, much like Adrian, goes off and reverse engineers all the RF commands for a Medtronic insulin pump for years. He does this for years on his own at night because he decided he wanted to, right? And that he should be able to control his insulin pump, he should be able to get data off his insulin pump. So he went off and did it. And it just sort of sat there, this stuff, okay? Until a couple of years ago, in fact, post Joy introducing me back to John Kostick again, a bunch of us started talking about, hey, can we wirelessly control our insulin? So something my son wanted is he doesn't want to pull his pump out to bolus all the time, okay? He's really good. He's totally compliant. He's in a great control. He's happy to bolus. He's not trying to, but, you know, man, you got to pull out the nerd thing again, and, geez, Dad, can't I just control? I can control my thermistor at my house with my iPhone. I've got an internet-controlled sprinkler system at my house, right? I can go to my iPhone right now and turn my sprinklers on. But I can't bolus. It makes no sense, right? So I started working on something called iHawk, okay, which uses Ben's software called DecoCare and a Raspberry Pi. What it allows you to do is take an off-the-shelf Medtronic insulin pump, okay, and remote bolus and remote basal and see how much your IOB is, okay? And this was a couple of years ago. Okay? And you say to yourself, and we'll talk about this in a second, oh my God, how is this not available? Right? It makes no sense. Right? It makes absolutely no sense. We'll talk about why in a second, but I think this was probably the first sort of remote control piece of some of this stuff. So OpenAPS, and maybe you've heard about that, that's an effort that's trying to close the loop, okay, on all this sort of stuff. So now that we can remotely control the pump, can we actually do a closed loop system? Right, with someday the idea of my son will have this closed loop system, he'll do nothing, it'll just take care of himself. We're still quite a ways away from that, okay? But OpenAPS is an effort by, again, Ben West, Dan Scott, I mentioned them, a guy named Chris Hanneman, Ray Cook, and there's probably literally 50 others, okay, who are literally building closed loop insulin pumps. Again, same Raspberry Pi like I use, there's a Dexcom attached to it, there's a CareLink that does the RF to the pump. Okay, and they're actually getting pretty good results, okay? This is Ali Marazzi's kid from Microsoft. I think one of you guys mentioned Ali. Here's his son right now sleeping with one. Ryan has one. There's many, many people out there way over sort of the 12 that most people sort of know about. I'd say probably there's closer to 20 or 30 that are out there running right now. And you know what? It works. It's not perfect, okay? It's far from perfect, in fact, okay? But it's so much better than nothing. People are willing to take the risk of hacked software killing their child at night, right? You're willing to take risks like me because it helps, right? Because it helps. It's pretty amazing. Think about it, right? In this day and age, how do we get to the point where this is not a commercial product already? It's really kind of sad if you think about it, okay? But that's the state we're in. In fact, we'll give you one other example. So this is actually Gustavo Munoz. He's, again, my partner. He's got one that's even a full step above that where he doesn't even need to tell it that he's eating, right? It's so aggressive. It actually senses, has he just eaten, right? Starts to bolus him automatically. Okay, it's sort of the next step even past some of the simple OpenAPS stuff. And he wears this, in fact, that's his giant pack that he wears around all day with a little Raspberry Pi and all the same kind of hardware in it. So this stuff is real. It's happening. Okay, it's happening, and it really does help. I mean, Gustavo's control is fairly amazing on this thing. Okay, but the question is why is this not available? Okay, So this is from the FDA. I think this was a diabetes mine last year. People are laughing, right? So the FDA puts up an overhead a year ago. Okay? Scenario. Private citizen creates a do-it-yourself device like an artificial pancreas. Right? And shares it with others. And that was the end of the presentation. They basically stopped. They said, well, we don't know what to do. Okay, because they really don't. We are all the way into uncharted territory now. Right? We're way, way, way into uncharted territory. And the thing that is, and I'll just leave you with this, you know, my son Ryan sits today and he's in chemistry class or something right now, and there's hacked software by me who has absolutely no business writing software that's going to, you know, necessarily kill somebody, okay, keeping him safe. And that's a pretty sad state. So who should I blame? Who should I blame? FDA is the easy one, right? They've slowed stuff down. It's you know, regulatory is too hard. Companies can't innovate. There's truth to that. Absolutely. Maybe I should blame the med device companies. Okay, even regardless of the FDA, they haven't gotten us there, right? Like it, don't like it. Well, this technology is fairly straightforward. It's not there. I cannot buy Ryan with any amount of money right now a commercially available artificial pancreas, right? Maybe I should blame Joyce. She's my healthcare giver. She has not pushed the large med device companies and the FDA to get me a solution, right? So, but who cares, right? Because the answer is, it really doesn't matter. And that's why I think we're not waiting, right? That to me is what really pushed me over the edge to do some of this stuff, and I think along with everyone else, okay? And it was really, again, Night Scout that gave us the inspiration to do this. So hopefully that was interesting. Thanks for your time.